Hey there, everyone. I'm back with another installment of property-based testing shown on the real-world code of SerenityOS. And today we'll take a look at a specific class from the project and try to figure out what properties and, you know, opportunities for tests we can find. And we will find out that, you know, functions that don't have any obvious properties by themselves often come in pairs, and they do have some kind of relationship together that we can extract a property from. A common example on this is what we often call the round trip property, where you have functions like decode and encode, compress and decompress, pack and unpack, get and set, and so on. I will not be only showing these, but they are a very common pattern. So, you know, round trip property is something to be on the lookout for. Anyways, let's get into the code. So the class in question is AK complex. I am already showing the tests here. And all right, so let's make this bigger. As the name suggests, it deals with complex numbers, meaning numbers with a real component and an imaginary component, where I squared equals minus one. And if we look into its API, we see, you know, some constructors, some getters, functions to calculate stuff like magnitude and phase, you know, which together make kind of an alternative representation of the same number using the polar coordinates. There is a constructor from the polar coordinates, and then we have, you know, some operators, right? So we can add those numbers, subtract them, multiply, divide, that sort of stuff. Again, in C++, we have to have different operators for, you know, assignment ones and for like the binary operator ones. And yeah, so operators again, and then we have, you know, I think this is complex exponentiation. So let's take a look at the test file, and there is a single test, and it's kind of like a kitchen sink of, you know, different stuff, trying to pin down a bunch of specific small examples. Not bad, but we can get a little bit more organized. In any case, I will not be touching this test here. I will just be adding tests at the bottom. So let's go back into the implementation file and think about, turn off the wrapping, and let's think about relationships between pairs of functions. So there are these constructors from real and imaginary components and getters for those components. So what about just checking that there's no funny business and that what you said is what you get later back, right? So we can, you know, we can test this this constructor that only takes the real number and basically puts zero into the imaginary component. So let's do that. So I can do randomize test case. Let's put one in there for like the arity. So this is going to be constructor one, constructor two. We can do constructor zero later, right? Let me also run the test. So I have a simple enter watcher. And so whenever I do something here, it should run it. See? Okay. Yeah. So we want to generate this real number and create a complex number from it. So generate the real component. It's going to be a float or like a double. And let's create the complex number using this construct that we are testing. And so what are we expecting? So the real part should be this number that we just put in, right? And the imaginary part should be zero. And this should be true for, you know, all real numbers that we put in. There shouldn't be any like magic, like if you put in minus one, the imaginary component is gonna be something different all of a sudden. It should always be like this. Let's try it. I need to add a using statement so that we can see the gen. Okay, so, right? We have tested our constructor. So this is not doing anything weird behind the scenes. And again, like, this is gonna be a theme. Things, I will be testing things that might seem silly and unnecessary, but if you look at it from the perspective of like me not seeing the contents of those functions, I basically just want to test the black box, right? Test it on a high level without knowing how it's implemented. So, you know, for all that I know, it could be converting these like real and imaginary numbers into the magnitude and phase and saving that, right? It could have the polar coordinates as, you know, the base representation. And it shouldn't matter, right? I basically just want to say, if I put in this real number, I should be able to get it back. All right, so let's do the second constructor with real and imaginary, both randomized. So imaginary is also going to be a float. Let's use that here. And we are going to have I there. Okay. Before I forget, let's do the zero arity constructor as well. We don't need randomized tests here because we are not randomizing anything. So it's just gonna be, it's just gonna be like that, and both should be zero. Let's see. Okay, let me just move it up there for OCD reasons. Okay, so that's those constructors. So there are some more, right? There's magnitude squared, phase, the polar constructor, and so on. So magnitude squared kind of suggests we should be able to test that if we do magnitude and magnitude squared, these are related, right? It's in the name. So perhaps, you know, magnitude squared should be magnitude, you know, to the second power squared. Yeah. So let's try that. First, let me create a generator helper for complex numbers, because we are going to be randomizing this whole complex number, not just the real and imaginary parts. So, again, generator for complex numbers. So real, imaginary, and we are going to return, we're going to use, you know, the full-fledged constructor, and we're going to return it. And now we can try to implement the test. So squared. Oops, what did I just? Okay, I started searching. It's always scary when you hit a random key in Vim. You never know what happens. So let's generate the complex number. Magnitude squared. Magnitude. And now let's expect that these are related. And we are going to use expect approximate because, they might use different algorithms to arrive at the same number, and floating point numbers have, inaccuracies and imprecisions. So it will be safer to give the comparison a little bit of tolerance. So magnitude squared should be equal to magnitude times magnitude. And we are missing a formatter for complex numbers because we basically every generated item needs a formatter. So let me go into the complex class and I will just magically copy paste this here. Right, so we are just gonna say real plus imaginary. Let me try to just show you how this would look. Oh, it passed. Okay, this is scary. Why? Okay, I do not know why this happened. Magnitude squared. Let me debug this a little bit. See, magnitude squared. And now let's run it normally. It's the complex. Oh, okay. So it's generating a lot of very large numbers. Okay. Yeah. This might be, this suggests that we are maybe our float generator could take some care. And this is something I have as work in progress. To basically just like try the edge cases and like be uniform in the middle of it. Let me create a variant of this that will it will try to do a little bit smaller numbers. We are gonna have some range for how big they can get. And we can try that here. And so how it's gonna look right now. Okay, so now this fails. Phew. Let's put that back. And the tests are passing. Okay, yeah. So I have a little bit of issue in this generator. It seems to prefer the maximum double right now. So yeah, we'll have to keep that in mind for this video. But, as you are writing tests, this should hopefully already be solved later. So, okay. And we have seen the formatter in action. That's good. Let me review these. And go back down. Okay, magnitude squared. So, right? And again, from the perspective of this test, we don't really care how this works. We don't know if it calls magnitude and like multiplies it by itself or if it's using some different algorithm. We don't care. And in fact, if we do take a look, we see that this is doing like almost Pythagorean theorem, but no square root, right? And this is using, I think the hypotenuse function is going to be just like, you know, the classic distance formula with square root of this. So yeah, we shouldn't care. We just know that these two are related. So let's go for some more tests. So we do have these like phase and magnitude getters, and we have the constructor from polar coordinates, right? So these kind of look like basically, again, constructor and getters, even though, you know, there's more stuff going on behind the scenes, because, you know, the complex class is holding everything as Cartesian coordinates. So they are being recalculated. So it's not just like setter and getter, but it should still behave like one. Or at least that's what I am thinking right now. You know, it's possible the test will tell us, oh, hey, actually, in this case, it does something a little bit different. So we are going to use from polar, and then we are going to get the magnitude back from it. So randomize this case for magnitude. So magnitude is going to be number. Phase also going to be a double. Now the complex number we are going to create from this will be, you know, using the from polar constructor. And let's expect the magnitude to be M. And this is wrong. So we are getting infinities. So again, we are working with very large numbers. So yeah, let's constrain them a little bit. Now we are not getting infinities anymore. Yeah, but it's giving us 1,000 basically, and we expected -1,000 because that's what we gave it. And so here is where we need to like take a look at Wikipedia or like what we are actually working with. And you know, so let me whip out some drawing area. All right. And so, you know, complex numbers. So the primer, you have, let's say the complex number is here. We have like the X or, you know, real axis. We have the Y or imaginary axis. And so, you know, if this number is like 2010, that's going to be 20 plus 10i, right? That's the number we have. And so the polar coordinates instead express things as length of this arrow, like distance from origin. So that's magnitude, and the angle. The angle, or is it theta or something? The angle from like the positive x-axis. And so length, a magnitude can never be negative, right? You cannot have something that is like minus 10 meters wide. And so that's what we are kind of doing here. We are giving it negative magnitudes and expecting we get them back. But no, it has to do like absolute value somewhere. Or it could like even throw the input out as like nonsensical, but it doesn't. It tries to work. So let's try zero. And now it passes. Right? Okay, so lesson learned, magnitudes cannot be negative. Or at least we will never get a negative magnitude out of it. So that's the magnitude. Now, what about the phase? So again, let's treat it as a dump getter and let the test framework tell us about the edge cases. Phase should be P. And again, we have some issues here. So again, the phase is very large. Perhaps there's some similar issue with like very large numbers. Like overflowing or something. I don't really know. It's kind of like hard to see the scale of those numbers. This seems like minus pi. This is very big, right? Or like minus maximum double and so on. Let's, like, for clarity, let's try to, limit those numbers a little bit. Okay, so what happens now? Again, this is better. There's no crazy numbers, but the code returns phase zero, and we expected phase minus 1000. And so again, this is where we need to take a look at the math. So let me go to Evernote again. So basically, phase is this angle. And if I just gave it, it's in radians, so one circle is going to be 2π radians, or 360 degrees. And so one thing to take a note about is that if you just like give it a very large number, it will just like go looping, right? And so then a very large phase is going to be the same as if you just went around once, right? To like this angle. And so there's going to be some like modulo happening, or basically it will try to remove as many multiples of 2π as possible. And also, if you look at Wikipedia, phase is usually, it's not in like 0 to 2π, it goes from minus pi to pi, right? And so we are probably gonna have to like expect something a little bit different from the phase. We can't really expect it to be the P we started with. Okay, so with magnitude of zero, This is also interesting, right? The test fails with magnitude of zero. And so magnitude of zero means we are right here in the middle. And like there's no specific angle that we are pointing at. Right? It's not this one. Or it could be like all of them, any angle. And so this is gonna be a little bit of an edge case. And so we could, you know, test, we could make a unit test for, okay, what happens when the magnitude is zero? How does the function behave? And there is a specific answer to that. And I think we, no, actually, let's not talk about it. Let's, for now, just circumvent this like specific edge case and have a non-zero magnitude, right? So let's try this. And now we are failing, but it's a little bit clearer, right? So left-hand side, which is the phase that we are getting back, is some number, which is good. Right-hand side, of course, is still very naive. And now we can probably start thinking about those like multiples of 2 pi. So let's see if the difference 0, 2, 6, 4, 6, 3, 8, 4. It's basically a multiple of pi, right? If I had enough precision in here, right? It's 318, you know, loops around the circle. So we probably need to expect a little bit different number. And so how to do that? Okay. First, let's confirm this hypothesis. We can try to just like generate phase in the same range. And this could be, this will work, right? Because we don't need to then do any like cancellation of those extra loops. But let's make the test a little bit stronger and keep those like, you know, extra numbers and see how the function behaves for those, right? So not only we get clarity on like the normal case, but also on those like a little bit weirder cases. And we can find how the result is related to what we put in. And so to cancel those multiples of 2 pi, I think we need to do modulo. So let's do wanted p as a wanted phase, and let's use fractional mod. And let's modulo by 2 pi. Okay, so what happens now? It looks like, again, left-hand side is, you know, 2.45. Right-hand side looks like, what is it? Oh, no. This is almost zero, right? This is almost zero. Right-hand side looks to be minus 2 pi. And again, because this is almost zero, we get almost 2 pi here. So looking at our diagram, if we have, you know, this is zero, this is 5 pi, this is 2 pi, minus pi, minus 2 pi. We are currently somewhere around here, while the result is somewhere around here, right? And I believe with different, you know, initial phases, we could land somewhere around here as well. So we want to really get into here, right? And so let's fix this situation by, if we are below minus pi, let's add 2 pi. If we are above pi, let's subtract 2π, right? And so this should put us somewhere in the range. So let's try to do that. So if we are above minus pi, let's subtract. And if we are below minus pi, let's add. Right? And so this should give us phase that like doesn't change except for those like multiples of 2π. And now the test passes. Great. So yeah, this was a little bit involved, but again, this is like the essential complexity of magnitude and phase, right? That's just like what complex numbers are. Okay, so let's continue. Let's see what we can do about some more tests. Continuing in the implementation file, we now have those operators, right? And I think what would make the most sense here would be to just write a bunch of unit tests with like specific examples and pin down, you know, specific inputs to specific outputs. I'm not going to do that here, but even without those examples, we can have some property-based general, you know, we can find some general properties there. And so let's say adding a complex number or adding a non-complex number to a complex number should only touch the real part, right? Because if you have this number here and you are adding a non-complex number, which is always on this line, you will only move it to the right. You will never move it like up and down. So that seems like something we can test. So adding real number to complex number shouldn't touch the imaginary part. Let's do that. And let's do that for plus, and then later I think we can do it for minus, perhaps. We'll see. So let's generate a complex number. Let's generate a real number. And right, so this is using one of those operators somewhere, plus equals perhaps, right? And we can see, like from a glance, it only touches the real part and not the imaginary part. So expect the imaginary part to be the same as before the addition. So let's do that. And we've got a compiler error. That's kind of unexpected. So it seems like adding a real number to a complex value doesn't work. It doesn't compile even. But you know, the operator definitely is there, right? And there are like other, you know, the one above was the silent one, but we also have just like these other ones. So the operators are there and we are getting the error in line 86, which is the assignment one, because that's what the binary operator one delegates to. And so, you know, this seems like a copy-paste error. Perhaps we just did like this and changed the type and just like removed the imaginary number, the imaginary part. But you know, u is a float or an integer or something like that, so it has no real component here. It has no real method. So let's try to change it like this. And it passes now. Right. So yeah, we found a bug. It's probably like the bug would have been found whenever somebody used this operator, right? It was just unused and like nobody found out. So let's do the same thing for subtraction. So minus, and sure enough, it has the same issue. Parenthesis as well. Okay. So yeah, so this operator is fixed. All right. I think we cannot really do the same thing for multiplication and division because those do touch all the parts. So we cannot check this property for multiplication. So let's go for some more operators. So those were the assignment ones. Now we have the binary operator ones. So they should behave the same way as the assignment ones, right? And again, from a high-level perspective, we don't know that they do delegate to them. It's just a high-level property, but that they should do the same thing. It's still the same addition. It's still the same subtraction. So we have, again, pairs of functions or, you know, methods or operators. And so doing A plus equal B should be, you know, should give you the same result as if you just did A plus B, right? So let's try that. Randomize this case. So we have those two numbers, and now output from the binary operator is C1 plus C2. And let's now try to do the assignment one. And so C1 plus equals C2. And those should be the same. And so we have a failure. And again, we have, you know, infinity and infinity. So we probably were just like, we went past the maximum double again. So let's do our usual dance of just like limiting those numbers. So what do we have now? So left-hand side. Oh, okay. This is actually my mistake here. Out to should be the one that does the assignment. And now it passes. Let me try to see if the issue persists here. It doesn't. Okay, so that was a false alarm. This kind of like reminds me of the commutativity rule. But first, let's try the same thing on, you know, subtraction and stuff. Minus, let's do that. Okay. Times. I think again we are getting something due to our large numbers. Let's try to limit it here. Okay. And division orit. Right, so that's those pairs of operators. Now I said this reminds me of commit activity rule, because we are kind of like saying this doesn't matter the order in which we are doing those things. Well, I think this should be true for complex numbers in general, right? C1 plus C2 should be the same as C2 plus C1. I think so. Let's see. Maybe the test will tell us that is not the case. Randomized test case commutativity. C2. Oops. I'm not sure if I should use approximate here. Let's see what happens. If we are strict, it seems to work. Okay. Now, I actually wonder, like, I am using expect equals here, but as I said, this could be dangerous with floats. That's why we use approximant. If we try to arrive at the same number in different ways, sometimes, you know, the errors just like pile up enough for the equality to start failing. And so I am not very happy with like keeping this EQ here. Let's do something else. So we have the approximate, but that only works for floats, right? So we can do something like expect complex. And we can like do expect approximate on the real parts and then on the imaginary parts, right? This will not compile. I need to do some template stuff and this should be fine. So let me use that. Yeah, of course, it did work with the EQ. I just want to be safe about it. So moving on, scrolling down, there are also some unary operators. Here they are, right? So they take no arguments except for, of course, for this. And so plus is interesting. Plus does nothing. So maybe, you know, this tells me this could be like idempotency law, which usually means running a function twice is the same as running it once. But here we can be a little bit more extreme. Running it once has the same output as not running it at all, right? So yeah, we can definitely test that. So it's going to be something like plus C equals C, right? So unary plus is going to be in no op. And we can use the strong expect equals here, because basically if this was to do anything to the complex number, you know, running it like 10 times might introduce, like, we might lose precision with each one, so that would be bad. So we want to make sure, you know, this doesn't do anything to it. So let's see. Right, yeah, that's simple enough. And with negation, you know, negation also kind of behaves as we would expect in like for real numbers that we are used to. So -1 is the same as just 1, right? Negation cancels out with itself. So it's all inverse. And the same should be true for complex numbers. So let's try that. Negation inverse. So we are gonna generate complex number, and here, you know, each of those calls is gonna do something to it. So I think we should rather use the approximate complex expectation. So minus C should be the same as C. All right. So now looking at the rest of this file, jumping outside of the complex class itself, we see a few more operator definitions. And these are basically just to allow you to write, you know, 1 plus C instead of C plus 1. And I think this is something we can test as well, right? These should always have the same output. These should always do the same thing. So at least for, you know, the plus operation. So let's generate a complex number. Let's generate a real number. And R plus C should equal C plus R. All right. Yeah. And so this looks very much like, you know, a commutative law for the two complex numbers we wrote a few moments back. This one just handles a complex number and a real number instead. And so this works for addition. It should also work for multiplication, right? That's just like scaling. That should work both ways, but it will not work for subtraction and division because there the order of the arguments is important. But what we can test for all of these, so even for subtraction and division, is that basically like wrapping the real number in a complex number and then running the operation doesn't change anything about the result, right? So it could look something like, if I have R plus C, then if I first convert the real number to a complex number and then add C, that should be the same. And the same thing with all the other operators. So let's try that. So we want to again create a complex number, create a real number, and then we want to wrap the real number in a complex number, right? So let me copy paste these. Since we are gonna be multiplying, and like even addition is problematic with the huge numbers with like max double, let's limit those right away. And now we can wrap the real number in a complex number. And let's try with the strict one. So R plus C is the same as C R plus C. And Let's do the edge operators as well. All right, and we get a failure. So let's see what it is server found. So somehow in the, what is it? It is the minus case, right? We have multiple expectations here, so it is the minus one. We are getting 1000 die for the left-hand side, so for unwrapped case, and 1000 I for the wrapped case. So this, so which one is the real, the correct one? Minus 1000 minus minus 1000 should cancel out. And since we are subtracting this one, we should get plus 1000. Right? Yeah, I think that makes sense. So somehow this operator is doing something weird. And seeing it also breaks on the division makes me think the order of the arguments is what's problematic here. And so if we look at these operators, something that's, again, like I have a hunch, this immediately looks weird, right? So an operator has left hand side and right hand side. And so why is it B and A instead of A and B? And then you look at it and see, okay, it uses the right one and then does something with the left one as an operator. So I think this is what's wrong. So let me just try to switch those. A, B. Oh God, A, B. Almost. And so what's gonna happen now? Okay, now the test pass. So yeah, all right, so that was encouraging. We found a bug. Yeah, so basically it wouldn't have mattered for plus and multiplication, but the order does matter for minus and division. So having accidentally swapped the order of the operands there did create a bug. All right. So while we are at it, we could perhaps do one more thing. We did things in this order, so real plus complex. We could also try complex plus real, right? So let's just move these. And let's try it out. And okay, we are getting some failure here as well. Let's see what it is. So it's the division. And left-hand side is 1 plus basically 1i. And right-hand side is also 1 plus almost 1i. And so the difference is just like in the very last digit, right? So it's the tiny differences. We talked about those. I think we should just like expect approximate complex and it will give us those tolerances. Yeah, and now it passes. Let's try it again. Yep, should be good. So, right, okay, so that's that. And below these operators, you know, there's real unit. There are some like constants. We might pin those with unit tests, but let's not do that here. Approximately equal. Yeah, that's something we perhaps could have used in our, you know, in this function. So we could have done, I don't even know what, like boolean expect what? Oh, no. Is it inside the namespace? I don't think, you know. Maybe something like complex efforts equals AB. Maybe that would have done it. But yeah, I am fine with what we have. So that's this function. And now there's the complex exponentiation. And so I am not like, no property jumps into my head, you know, from the get-go. Maybe something like repeated multiplication. We might have done that, but yeah, let's keep that out for now. Maybe, you know, maybe we could just like pin it down with specific examples in a unit test. Or maybe we could look at like Math World, Wikipedia, or some other site to basically find properties to test. Okay, so let's skip that. This formatter, this is one we have added. So we are at the bottom. So yeah, as you can see, we only did like a shallow pass. We searched for the low-hanging fruit, right? We didn't consult the internet for like any really esoteric properties. And many of the properties that we did find were just like common sense. You know, they touched the OOP constructor-getter relationship instead of some math equations. There was, you know, with the OOP constructor and getter stuff, we had it twice, right? So it was the Cartesian form and real and imaginary getters. And then there was the polar form and magnitude and phase. And you could kind of see those as the round trip property, right? So if you encode it through that constructor and take it back, it should be the same. So yeah, it like the analogy kind of breaks with the polar ones because they don't give you back what you put in. And that was really interesting, wasn't it? So it really surprised me when I wrote that code because I didn't really think about like coming with the perspective of this is just a getter and setter. I should just like put something in, get the same thing back. That wasn't the case, right? Magnitude means something. It like it's a distance. It cannot be negative. And phase, it's, you know, it's kind of like circular, and so it cancels out those multiples of 2π. Yeah, so, you know, I didn't know that about it, and the tests told me, right? The test told me, no, you expected to get back like minus 1000, but we gave you 1000, or we gave you some other number, right? And I needed to update my mental model. So that's really nice. Property-based tests go both ways. They give you confidence that the system works the way you want, or they tell you, no, you know, something's wrong. Either the system is buggy or your idea of how it should work is buggy. Your specification is buggy. And in this case, with the polar coordinates, my understanding of it was buggy. And that got fixed as well. And speaking about real bugs in the code, we found two, right? So that was pretty nice. One of those was just like a copy-paste problem that like didn't get found because the code didn't get used. So maybe we could take a look at like code coverage, right? Code coverage could tell us, okay, this function, this operator is not used. And we could try to, you know, push this percentage. And the second bug was much more interesting, I think, because it kind of worked, not always. But, you know, subtraction and division, they are not commutative. And so doing B minus A will not always give you the same result as A, sorry, as A minus B. And yeah, so we found like argument order bug, I guess. Pretty nice. All right. Yeah. So as a takeaway, it's quite powerful to look at pairs of functions at once. You don't just need to see a function, a method or something and like try to figure out what can I test about it. You can sometimes, you know, looking at two functions at once will, you know, help you with this kind of like writer's block, or I don't know how to call it, but it's much easier to think about like what's always true if I do this and then I do that, than if you just say what's always true if I do this. So yeah, it just might, you know, get the creative juices flowing. So that's something I sometimes do. Look at pairs of functions and test interaction of those two things. You could imagine, you know, if you are testing some hash map or dictionary, like answering the question of what's always true if I insert, is not as easy as when you imagine what if I insert and delete. Well then, okay, well, if I delete the same thing that I inserted, something should happen. If I deleted something else should happen, right? It's, I don't know, it's kind of, it's easier to think about. So that's it for this episode. And in the next one, I'm quite excited about it. We'll take a look at some heavy weapons. Model-based testing is what it's called. And in short, we are going to make a simplified model of our system that we want to test. For example, our circular queue, or, you know, it could be some kind of buffer or something. And you generate sequences of operations on it. And, you know, they are interleaved in interesting ways. And then you run those operations on both the test, on the system under test and on your model, and everything should agree, right? Like all observable behavior should be the same. And, you know, if it is not, property-based tests can, you know, shrink down the sequence of operations, so they will find the tiniest sequence that still triggers the bug. And this is quite powerful. There are a lot of anecdotes. I think I maybe told those anecdotes in previous video, so bear with me. But, you know, there was this example of Google LevelDB database being tested in this way. And they have found like 17 operations that resulted in like a deleted key being found again, and, you know, Google fixed the bug and they just ran the test again. It found like 33 operations that resulted in the same bug. So I think this like packs a lot of power. So I'm quite excited to show it to you. Stay tuned for that, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye.